Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The American Chestnut, An Environmental History, by Donald Edward Davis. Narrated by Jonathan Yen. Publisher's Note: This audiobook will refer to visual elements included in the print and ebook editions of the book. Now we read of this, of the 100-foot tree that once, in airy white blossom or heavy with pods of food, distilled the American earth for us. At Mount Vernon, the Washington's roast wild turkey was sown, stuffed with chestnuts. Cattle and deer fattened or held to life on the winter meat of chestnuts. Now one book of trees says, only a few scattered sucker growths remain. Nothing to replace it, maybe never again. That fruit, a brown dimension like nothing else in nature. When newly fallen, of such a swirled, teardrop shine, that even our children's eyes seemed made with less skill. William Hayen, from The Chestnut Rain. Preface. On December 21, 2013, when best-selling author Bernd Heinrich announced in a New York Times op-ed that he would be eating American chestnuts for Christmas, the response was predictable. Readers assumed he had his facts wrong, believing the nut-bearing trees on his property were foreign or hybrid varieties. Heinrich admitted the chestnuts might not be native, but was hopeful they indeed were, as he had purchased them from a Michigan grower in 1981. Not only did the trees thrive after being planted on his main farm, one of the original seedlings was now 35 feet tall. More impressive was the fact that the trees had produced 150 progeny, seedlings scattered across some 200 acres of forest. The young trees, discovered Heinrich, had been planted by jays after the birds failed to unearth their cache of buried nuts. As a result, the trees had become a significant component of the forest ecosystem and even afforded him the luxury of roasting chestnuts by the fire. Although the response to Heinrich's op-ed was largely positive and replete with nostalgic comments about the trees and their possible return, some doubted the veracity of the report or took objection to his comments about genetically engineered, GE, chestnuts. Among the objectors was William Powell of the SUNY College of Environmental Science and Forestry. Heinrich was aware that Powell had planted GE chestnuts at the New York Botanical Garden in 2012 and made it known that he did not want the genome of the native trees altered. "Yes, I would love to see the American chestnut restored to our forests," wrote Heinrich, "but do we need to alter the chestnut's genome, the code of life that has evolved over millenniums? I don't think so. And I worry that the feel-good campaign in the Bronx could be a Trojan horse that may seduce the public into accepting other genetically engineered trees." To appease those doubting the origins of his chestnuts, thinking they were not native trees, Heinrich located their true source. In his 2014 book, The Homing Instinct: Meaning and Mystery in Animal Migration, Heinrich recounted their journey to his main farm, stating the nuts had been purchased from the American Chestnut Council in Cadillac, Michigan. For decades, the American Chestnut Council had access to groves of native, blight-resistant chestnuts, and thus was able to ship seed stocks across the United States. Heinrich was elated that the trees were the native variety, but was uncertain about their resistance to the blight fungus. "Could some have survived because they were resistant to it?" he asked. "Or were they saved simply because of their isolation?" Heinrich's query is not an uncommon one, and represents the many questions that continue to be asked about the species, even by well-informed naturalists. This book was written in part to answer such queries, as well as shape public policy regarding the future reintroduction of the tree. Presently, the return of the American chestnut shows as much possibility of failure as it does promise, despite media reports claiming breakthroughs have been made toward that end. Correcting certain misconceptions about the trees, including their future chances for survival, was an important aim of this book. To claim the trees were king of the eastern forest, as Heinrich and others have done, is also not entirely factual. The trees were certainly a dominant, if not foundational, species across the Appalachians, but elsewhere the trees seldom comprised more than one-tenth of any wooded area. And when trees did reach higher densities outside the so-called chestnut belt, it was often due to human activities, such as forest clearance, charcoal production, or anthropogenic fire. Another common misconception about the American chestnut is that its natural range is relatively fixed and will remain so in the near and distant future. Many have assumed, for example, that the map produced by dendrologist Elbert E. Little for the U.S. Department of Agriculture in 1977 represents the true historic range of the American chestnut. However, Little's map, which is recognized by government agencies as well as the American Chestnut Foundation, does not include areas where the trees were found prior to the introduction of Phytophthora disease, a subject discussed at length in Chapter 5. Before that time, the trees were found along the mid-Atlantic coastline and much of the southern Piedmont. Nor does Little's map include the small but important chestnut groves that resulted from the naturalization of the tree outside its historic range, such as those found in Michigan and Wisconsin. Indeed, the most current attempts to redraw the range of the American chestnut, using botanical collections, field surveys, and historical references, fail to capture the full range of Castanea dentata prior to the 19th century. Although the map published in the North American Plant Atlas in 2015 shares many similarities with the range map found in this book, see Figure 3.1, a number of the outlying trees identified in the atlas are likely Allegheny or Ozark chinquapins, or even American chestnut chinquapin hybrids. Nevertheless, historical evidence suggests the natural distribution of the American chestnut extended across more than 400,000 square miles of territory, an area stretching from eastern Maine to southeast Louisiana. Determining the historic range and prevalence of the tree is important for a number of reasons. First of all, such knowledge tells us that all chestnut habitats are not created equal. Some parts of eastern North America were less suitable for the species and did not support large numbers, even before the arrival of both Phytophthora and the Cryphonectria parasitica fungus. The awareness that extreme temperature and moisture levels also influence chestnut mortality is another important lesson for those seeking to resurrect the native tree. Obviously, more emphasis should be placed on growing chestnuts in areas with the most optimal soil types, rainfall amounts, and temperatures, as well as the fewest recorded instances of pests and diseases. For this reason, the southern Appalachians, which were once home to the largest and densest chestnut forests in the eastern United States, may not be the best regeneration niche for completing this task. Maine and Michigan could actually be more suitable for reviving the American chestnut, since environmental conditions in those states, at least in the 21st century, appear more conducive to the tree's growth and vigor, yet at the same time, unfavorable to both Phytophthora and the cryphonectria fungus. The findings of a 2019 study support such claims, as the authors anticipate a northerly shift in the tree's range. Their findings, based on climate change and species distribution modeling, predict not only a reduction in suitable habitat for the species, but also the emergence of new habitat niches. After 2050, portions of southern Ontario and Nova Scotia, as well as the island of Newfoundland, may possess the most suitable growing conditions for Castanea dentata. Equally important to this discussion is an informed understanding of how and when the trees spread across the North American landscape. Pollen recovered from the bottom of perennial ponds and sand dunes provides evidence the trees inhabited a very small geographic area during the last ice age. Only after the hemisphere warmed and precipitation levels increased did the American chestnut shift its range northward. It did so, on average, 110 yards annually due to hundreds of thousands of nut movers, including mice, squirrels, jays, crows, and passenger pigeons. Passenger pigeons and crows were most likely responsible for introducing the trees into the Appalachian uplands, as both birds were known to visit high-elevation mountaintops during feeding and roosting forays. Even with the assistance of birds and mammals, it took 5,000 years for the trees to colonize what is today the state of Georgia, and another 10 millennia for the trees to reach northern New England and Canada. Such lessons in ecological history are particularly relevant for those who believe American chestnut restoration can be accomplished in a single century. Even with the assistance of armies of tree planters and the most ideal growing conditions, the trees will need at least a millennium to become re-established in the eastern hardwood forest. Moreover, as I argue in the final chapter, not all restoration efforts are created equal. In fact, some attempts to restore the tree to its former range might even threaten its long-term survival. There are always pitfalls in restoring landscapes to past desiderata, as ecosystems change considerably over time, with or without human intervention. It is important to know how the trees evolved across both time and space, particularly for decision makers wanting to return the species to its native habitat, or determine if such efforts are even warranted. Documenting the rise and fall of the American chestnut over the long durée and across different human and geographic landscapes is no easy task. In North America, humans lived among chestnuts for more than 10 millennia, and each influenced the other in unique and important ways. Needless to say, an environmental history of the American chestnut is timely, if not long overdue, especially for those wishing to ensure the future of this iconic tree species. Introduction. Giving character to the landscape. Humans love trees. They shade our homes in summer, provide convenient locations for play or rest, and give us warmth in winter. They symbolize fertility and regeneration, especially in springtime, when bursting buds and blossoms ensure us a new season will soon prevail. Trees connect us to specific places, providing us with a sense of direction, and in some locales, where a single species dominates the landscape, community identity. Wooded places evoke, as the geographer Yi Fu Tuan once observed, joy, fear, mystery, grief, tradition, and childhood memories. Urban dwellers also have an affinity for trees and often go to great pains to make sure city parks and streetscapes are safe and permanent homes for their sylvan companions. Ironically, the tree that most piqued the emotions of 19th and early 20th century Americans, the American chestnut, has virtually disappeared from the eastern United States. As is discussed in subsequent chapters, the American chestnut became functionally extinct during the first four decades of the 20th century after the introduction of an exotic fungus on Japanese chestnut nursery stock. Before that time, the tree played a central role in the ecology, economy, and material culture of the eastern United States. From Maine to Mississippi, the American chestnut evoked memories of street vendors, community gatherings, picnics, holiday feasts, small and big game hunting, fence building, shingle splitting, livestock husbandry, and even moonshining. For residents of Appalachia, where the trees defined the pre-World War II landscape, the loss of the American chestnut even served as a metaphor for the passing of a self-sufficient and forest-dependent way of life. Thousands of communities in the United States and Canada remain home to places bearing the chestnut name, including streets, cemeteries, schools, churches, and post offices. Numerous mountains, ridges, hills, knolls, valleys, streams, and ponds are also prefaced by the chestnut adjective. Although some locales were home to only a single grove of trees, many areas possessed large and impressive stands. George Ramsour, who lived in southeast Tennessee during the 1930s, recalled that chestnut trees atop the Cumberland Plateau were as common as the moon rising and sun setting. The mountainous portions of Kentucky, West Virginia, North Carolina, and Pennsylvania also contained large numbers of trees, but they could also be found in lower elevations. Chestnut Neck, New Jersey, for example, a colonial village that was the site of an important Revolutionary War battle, got its name from the many chestnuts that once grew in the township, even though the terrain there is less than 10 feet above sea level. During the second half of the 19th century, in America's largest cities, chestnut trees were planted along major thoroughfares, where they shaded urban pedestrians in warmer months and fed them during colder ones. In the summer of 1859, a New York Times writer editorialized that in parts of Manhattan, where the wealthy still own land by the block, individuals were planting avenues of chestnuts and elms. In America's first planned suburb, Baltimore's Roland Park, native chestnut trees were touted as a drawing card for future residents. During the mid-1890s, a frequently posted advertisement in the Baltimore Morning Herald announced, "The more you see of Roland Park, the more it grows on you. It is an improved piece of property with beech and ash, sycamore and chestnut, which shade while they shelter. All are here, for they have been here for years and years, and are no less delightful on that account." The trees remained a visible part of the Roland Park landscape for at least another decade, as evidenced by a 1902 article from the Baltimore Sun Society pages. "Mr. and Mrs. William M. Ellicott gave a tea and chestnut hunting party yesterday afternoon to the instructors and pupils of the Arundel School at her residence," states the notice. An experienced raccoon hunter was engaged to climb and thresh the chestnut trees, and the nuts were eagerly gathered from the ground by the children, regardless of leaves and burrs falling upon their heads. Smaller townships also encouraged the planting of native chestnuts, as local residents perceived the trees as natural capital that might pay future dividends. In 1893, Maine tavern keeper Samuel Farmer pleaded for his neighbors to invest in a chestnut orchard, citing the success of Temple, a town in the western part of the state that planted American chestnut trees from Massachusetts in the late 1840s. 45 years later, proclaimed Farmer, The trees are over 2 feet in diameter, and in height and general size have outgrown all other trees in their vicinity. It is a valuable tree for timber and is used for telephone poles, railroad ties, fence posts, sawed timber, and plank. In fact, the American chestnut's many uses made it one of the country's favorite species, causing several writers to christen it the perfect tree. Indeed, in 1915, when New England forester Philip L. Buttrick discussed the tree's importance to the U.S. economy, he announced it possessed more uses than all other American hardwoods, exclaiming that it touches almost every phase of our existence. To fully bolster his argument, he added that the tree serves as a shade and ornamental tree on our parks and estates. Its wood is used in the building and decoration of our houses and the manufacture of our furniture. We sit down in chairs made of chestnut and transact our business at desks of chestnut, veneered with oak. We receive messages from the distance over wires strung on chestnut poles. We sit in a railroad train and read newspapers into whose composition chestnut pulp has gone, while our train travels over rails supported on chestnut ties and over trestles built of chestnut piles, along a track whose right-of-way is fenced by wire supported on chestnut posts. On the same train travel goods shipped in boxes and barrels made of chestnut boards and staves. Even the leather for our shoes is tanned in an extract made from chestnut wood. At last, when the tree can serve us no longer in any other way, it forms the basic wood to make our coffins. Perhaps the most pleasurable memories associated with the American chestnut involve the annual consumption of nuts, which started in late September and continued through the colder winter months. In urban areas along the eastern seaboard, from Washington, D.C. to Boston, the motley-dressed sidewalk vendor who roasted and sold chestnuts was seen as the harbinger of the holiday season. By mid-November, the aroma from chestnut vendors' pushcarts was nearly inescapable, making it difficult for city dwellers to keep their spare change. In 1898, a reporter for the Boston Evening Transcript commented on the sensual allure of roasting chestnuts, wryly stating it was the incense of the vendor's trade that was his best advertisement. There are few who can permanently resist the sweet savor sent up by the chestnut roaster, observed the writer. They may wish the vendor had a little cleaner hands and a little more wholesome attire, but one sense contends against the other, and at last they are likely to shut their eyes, and the sense of smell triumphs. Chestnuts were also important in rural areas during the winter season, feeding both the eyes and stomachs of those fortunate enough to live near a stand of nut-bearing trees. However, in parts of southern Appalachia, the nuts were less likely to be eaten than to be bartered for needed provisions at the crossroads store or fed to livestock for winter fattening. But even in the most remote areas of the tree's native range, it would be difficult to find a single individual who did not taste a handful of chestnuts before year's end. Northeast Alabama resident Marie Smith Washburn recalled that as late as the 1920s, her family tried to maintain their annual store of chestnuts until Christmas Day. "Well, as far back as I can remember, we always had chestnuts to eat, and when I got big enough to go up to the field up there where they were, Daddy would have us picking them up. He'd sack them up and try to hide them from us, but we'd find them. And he'd say, 'Now don't eat them all up. We've got to have some for Christmas.'" In late spring or early summer, depending upon the geographic location of the stand, the American chestnut again assaulted the senses of those living near, or passing by, the largest trees. After chestnut trees fully leaf out, they produce hundreds of long, delicate catkins that turn from green to white in a matter of a few weeks. Accompanying the catkins is a strong, pungent odor, which some commentators, including Henry David Thoreau, found disagreeable or even offensive. Others were more kind, however, using adjectives ranging from delicate to heavy when describing the odor of the blossoms. Visually, the trees were a sight to behold, turning entire mountainsides a creamy yellow, and then, as the catkins began to release their pollen, a sugary white that, from a distance, resembled snow. 19th-century travel writers Wilbur Ziegler and Ben Groskopf, who spent considerable time exploring the mountains of western North Carolina, said it was the glory of the chestnut blossom that was responsible for them giving character to the landscape. As a result, the annual chestnut blossom was the impetus for the naming of dozens of mountains and ridges in the Appalachians, including Yellowtop Mountain, North Carolina, Whitetop Knobs, Tennessee, Yellow Mountain, Georgia, and Little Yellow Mountain, Virginia. As significant as the American chestnut was to the American populace, the tree was not without detractors, especially those who believed its annual harvest could be improved. In some parts of the tree's range, it was an unpredictable nut producer, rarely making a bumper crop for more than 2 or 3 years in a row. And even though newly arriving immigrants found native chestnuts sweeter in their taste, their smaller size made them cumbersome to gather and process for the kitchen table. Moreover, 18th and 19th century America was settled largely by Europeans, all of whom had personal memories of much larger chestnuts in Italy, France, Spain, and the Balkans. In those countries, the European chestnut, Castanea sativa, was the dominant producer of nuts, which also explains their early importation to America. As early as 1773, Thomas Jefferson grafted 5 French chestnuts onto the stock of 2 American trees with hopes of producing a more marketable nut crop. 3 decades later, Eleuthère Irénée Dupont, at his Eleutherian Mills estate near Wilmington, Delaware, planted what was likely the first European chestnut orchard in the United States. The Dupont trees flourished for more than a century, as well as established the Wilmington-Philadelphia corridor as a center of commercial chestnut growing. While most Americans referred to European chestnuts by their country of origin, Spanish chestnuts, for example, few realized the trees had their origins in the Caucasus Mountains of Georgia and Turkey. In fact, the name of the scientific genus for all chestnut species, Castanea, derives from Kastane, a village in northwest Turkey where the trees became established after the late Bronze Age. Although paleobotanists believe humans were responsible for spreading European chestnuts westward into Greece and the southern Balkans before Roman times, there is evidence the trees existed in northern Italy and southern Germany before the 11th century BCE, surviving there as a relict species during the last glaciation. Although Romans may have taken chestnuts as far north as England, where they thrive in naturalized stands, it is more likely the trees were introduced into Britain during the 11th century, when they first appear in the historical record. The American chestnut also received competition from the Japanese chestnut, Castanea crenata, a species brought to America in 1876 by the Parsons Commercial Nursery of Flushing, New York. In 1882, horticulturalist William Perry imported 1,000 trees from Japan, grafted specimens which he planted at his New Jersey orchard along the Delaware River. The smaller size of the Japanese tree made it ideal for home orchards, and its extremely large nuts made it a favorite among commercial nut growers. By the end of the century, hundreds of acres of Japanese chestnuts were growing at a dozen nurseries devoted to chestnut production, including the Elm City Nursery in New Haven, Connecticut, the Mammoth Chestnut Company of Riverton, New Jersey, and the Storrs and Harrison Company of Painesville, Ohio. The Japanese chestnut did have its detractors, including New England forester Ernest A. Sterling, who complained the nuts were covered with a bitter skin which had to be removed before eating. Although Sterling found Japanese chestnuts more palatable after proper preparation and cooking, and thought the tree a valuable acquisition to American horticulture, he recommended the better-flavored European varieties for propagation. Imported chestnuts had an enormous impact on the native species, influencing their rapid decline and, ultimately, their renewed resurgence. In fact, it was the fin de siècle popularity of Japanese chestnuts that led to their unmonitored importation into the United States, and it was those trees that were infected with chestnut blight, setting into motion, sometime before 1900, what one biologist has called the greatest ecological catastrophe since the last ice age. The end result? The loss of an estimated 5 billion chestnut trees and 2 billion tons of biomass across more than 320 million acres of forests. In the 21st century, it is perhaps ironic that the Chinese chestnut, Castanea mollissima, provides one of the best hopes of returning the American chestnut to the eastern deciduous forest, as breeding programs that cross the two species have produced trees with significant levels of blight resistance. As an environmental history of the American chestnut, this book surveys the ecological history of the tree over the past 20,000 years and provides an informed discussion about human-chestnut relationships for half that period. For those unfamiliar with environmental history, the discipline emerged in the 1970s when communities in the United States were undergoing numerous environmental problems. Although the first environmental historians were trained in the study of history, individuals from other academic disciplines also joined their ranks. In the main, environmental history is simply the study of human-nature relationships over time in a particular geographic setting. It documents the impact of humans on the natural world, as well as the role and place of nature in human life. Initially, environmental historians focused on such topics as resource use, wilderness protection, air and water pollution, pesticides, and urban sprawl. Some also chronicled the impact of plants and animals on human history, including Alfred Crosby, who wrote about the Columbian Exchange as early as 1972. To date, the most notable environmental history of an individual tree species is the tan oak tree, a book about the acorn-producing hardwood native to California and Oregon. The tan oak has declined in recent years due to sudden oak death, an introduced pathogen of unknown origin. In The Georgia Peach, William Thomas Oakey carefully documents the history of peach production in the American South, which influenced everything from labor relations to popular culture. Jared Farmer's Trees in Paradise focuses on not one, but three tree species: the California redwood, the eucalyptus, and the orange tree. According to Farmer, California history is so intertwined with these trees that it would be a very different place if they were absent from the landscape. And finally, in Mesquite, Gary Paul Nabhan celebrates the cultural and ecological importance of one of the most common tree species in the American Southwest. As Nabhan notes, the mesquite tree possesses edible seed pods, provides the material for boutique furniture, and even gives unique flavor to smoked meats. Although environmental history has, to date, been largely the work of academicians, the discipline also has real-world implications for the natural environment. Proponents not only amplify the importance of nature in our collective past, but suggest ways in which humans, in the present and future, might enrich the natural world. The successful reintroduction of a blight-resistant American chestnut, for example, could dramatically alter the composition of the eastern deciduous forest, as well as increase populations of wild turkey, ruffed grouse, and black bear, game species that could in turn alter human consumption and recreation patterns. Local communities would also benefit from the restoration of the tree, as numerous businesses might be inspired by its return, including commercial nut growing and furniture manufacturing. With the increasing planting of blight-resistant chestnut trees on public and private lands, it is possible that North Americans will once again be roasting chestnuts over open fires and purchasing chestnut timber at local lumber yards. It is also possible that current attempts to restore the American chestnut will prove unsuccessful. Not only does the problem of chestnut blight need to be solved, but the landscape itself has to be more favorable to the reintroduction of the tree. The species does not thrive in all soils and terrains, and new pests and pathogens will undoubtedly play havoc with restoration efforts. Although the trees colonized large geographic areas in relatively short periods of geologic time, they also quickly vanished from forested landscapes, even in a single growing season. Over the millennia, the American chestnut has indeed been a species on the move, changing not only its natural range, but rising and falling in numbers. Part 1. Chestnuts on the Move. Chapter 1. The Evolutionary History of the Species. The story of the American chestnut begins some 90 million years ago, when a family of trees known as Fagaceae, the ancestors of all oak and beech species, became prevalent in temperate forests. At that time, such trees could be found across much of Laurasia, the supercontinent linking North America to both Europe and Asia. Although fossil evidence tells us the first plants of the Castanea genus appeared around 87 million years ago, a tree resembling the modern species did not inhabit the planet until the end of the Cretaceous period, some 22 million years later. Evolutionary biologists agree that chestnuts likely evolved from a closely related oak species occupying the eastern border of Laurasia, near what are today the islands of Japan. Around 60 million years ago, after the KT meteor event led to the extinction of dinosaurs, chestnuts spread westward toward Europe, as well as eastward, beyond the Bering Strait into Alaska. 5 million years later, as a result of fluctuating temperatures and geographic isolation, chestnuts in what is today Asia developed a new lineage, or clade, resulting in a tree closely akin to the Chinese chestnut. Both species coexisted over the next 12 million years, extending their ranges across the Laurasian continent. 43 million years ago, chestnuts near the western edge of Laurasia developed even more novel traits, becoming the progenitors of the European chestnut, a tree sometimes misidentified in the United States as the American species. Finally, around 40 million years before the present period, BP, chestnut trees inhabiting the landmass connecting Europe to North America again changed their genetic structure, becoming established just before the separation of the supercontinent. It was those trees that spread both westward and southward across much of North America. Among the North American lineage of trees was the American chestnut, Castanea dentata, one of nine Castanea species now populating the planet. Diversification of the Castanea genus occurred again at the end of the Oligocene epoch, some 24 million years BP, when chinkapins appeared alongside chestnuts in North American forests. The Ozark chinkapin, Castanea ozarkensis, a smaller version of the American chestnut, traces its genetic lineage to this clade of trees. Finally, about 20 million years ago, the Allegheny chinkapin, Castanea pumila, a small tree producing a single nut per burr, became established in North American woodlands. Chestnuts were common in the deciduous forests of the Northern Hemisphere, reaching their peak in number about 5 million years ago. At that time, a tree closely resembling the American chestnut inhabited the Rocky Mountains of northern Idaho, as verified by leaf imprints recovered at the Clarkia fossil site. See Figure 1.1. As the climate cooled before the first glaciations, chestnuts vanished from the northernmost latitudes of North America, Europe, and Asia, with some species becoming extinct about 2.6 million years BP. With the onset of what geologists refer to as the Quaternary period, enormous glaciers descended over the North American continent, initiating ice ages that lasted for as long as 50,000 years. Interglacial warming followed the cooling periods, which influenced the range and prevalence of North American flora, including the American chestnut. Climatologists tell us these warming-cooling cycles have repeated themselves no fewer than 8 times over the last 800,000 years, with the last major glaciation ending some 21,000 years ago. Although it seems impossible today, at the peak of the last ice age, there were virtually no American chestnuts living within the tree's native range. At that time, the Laurentide ice sheet, a glacier 3 miles high at its peak, covered portions of present-day New England, New York, Pennsylvania, and northern Ohio. The enormous glacier helped in lowering the Atlantic Ocean by as much as 400 feet, making the Florida Peninsula twice its current width. Below the glacier was a narrow band of tundra, a treeless plain that abruptly gave way to a boreal forest of birch, spruce, fir, and jack pine. Snowfields, krumholtz, and alpine meadows covered the Appalachian peaks as far south as North Georgia, high-altitude areas entirely void of trees. Below the boreal forest was an expanse of conifers and northern hardwoods, an area stretching from the southern Appalachians to the Mississippi River. An oak, hickory, and evergreen forest occupied the area extending from the 33rd parallel to northern Florida, where it was gradually replaced by savannas, salt marshes, and submerged wetlands. A diversity of tree species inhabited these southernmost forests, particularly along the Florida Panhandle and Georgia Barrier Islands. It is precisely this location where one finds the American chestnut some 25,000 years ago. We know the American chestnut survived in the Deep South during the last ice age thanks to palynologists, individuals who study the distribution of fossilized plant pollen in freshwater lakes and ponds, or, in some instances, the soil beneath undisturbed moss beds or sand dunes. Each year, trees release trillions of pollen grains into the atmosphere, and this yellow rain not only coats the surfaces of automobiles, sidewalks, and picnic tables, it also falls to the bottom of lakes and ponds, where it becomes buried under layers of silt. To recover and study this pollen, palynologists sink metal tubes into the bottoms of lakes and ponds, effectively coring the sediment layers. After the mud or peat cores are extracted, the grains are examined, measured, and preserved. Organic matter taken from the cores is then carbon dated, allowing researchers to ascertain when the pollen was deposited. After the pollenologist has, with the aid of a microscope, counted and identified the pollen grains, he or she is able to reconstruct, in the near and distant past, the ecological composition of the surrounding forest. Figure 1.2. Although their findings are not widely known, palynological studies challenge many commonly held notions about the impact of climate change on native flora and fauna, as well as the ability of trees to repopulate large expanses of territory in relatively short periods of geologic time. Harvard Forest Director David R. Foster has stated that such migrations are among the greatest biological stories of the North American landscape, demonstrating both the individualistic and adaptive nature of plant species. Although the American chestnut has a long history of environmental adaptation, fossil pollen places the tree at only a handful of locations at the peak of the last ice age. One of these sites is Goshen Springs in southern Alabama, a perennial lake referred to as the 40-acre pond, before it was drained in 1951. In the mid-1970s, the lake bed was cored by paleoecologists Paul and Hazel Delcourt, as the pair believed the surrounding area was a place of refuge for temperate hardwoods. The Delcourts postulated that the colder temperatures and drier climate of the Ice Age drove many deciduous trees into the bluffs and river bottoms of the Gulf Coastal Plain, where they remained until the Laurentide ice sheet retreated some 20,000 years ago. The pollen record at Goshen Springs corroborates their hypothesis, revealing that 29,000 years BP, the coastal forest was prime habitat for a variety of hardwoods, including the American chestnut. In a summary of their findings, published in the journal Ecology in 1980, Paul Delcourt estimated that as much as 28% of the sandy woodlands surrounding Goshen Springs was comprised of chestnut and, in descending order of frequency, pine, oak, sweet gum, hickory, black gum, beech, and elm. Another place of refuge for the species was Camel Lake, a perennial pond located 40 miles west of Tallahassee. The lake was cored for pollen in 1986 by William A. Watts, a paleoecologist who also served as the provost of Trinity College in Dublin and later the president of the Royal Irish Academy. At Camel Lake, Watts found the greatest amount of chestnut pollen around 30,000 years BP, when the trees comprised 20% of the surrounding area. 2,000 years later, chestnuts began disappearing from the site, before vanishing completely from the pollen record around 26,000 years ago. Although it seems unlikely a dominant species would be exterminated in only 4 or 5,000 years, a similar phenomenon occurred at Goshen Springs, where chestnut decline started around 29,000 years BP and ended several millennia later, when the trees vanished entirely from the area. To understand why Goshen Springs and Camel Lake were unsuitable for chestnuts, a review of the meteorological conditions is in order. 28,000 years ago, rainfall amounts were considerably lower across the southeastern United States. There was also more persistent cloud cover, limiting the amount of sunshine for photosynthesis. Carbon dioxide levels had declined by as much as 35%, further disadvantaging broad-leafed trees like the American chestnut. Evergreen trees were not as stressed by the drier climate as they could process CO2 year-round and thus maximize their water use efficiency. By the time the Laurentide ice sheet reached its southernmost limit, moisture-loving trees had migrated well below the fall line or retreated into the braided shoals and ravines bordering the streams and rivers of the Gulf and Atlantic coasts. In fact, these were the only locations in eastern North America where a drought-intolerant tree species could find safe haven, as annual rainfall amounts had dropped below 30 inches as far south as the Alabama and Georgia fall lines. Coupled with the drier conditions was also a dramatic decline in temperatures. In northern Florida, mean January temperatures were as low as 10 degrees Fahrenheit, and daytime temperatures did not rise above freezing for several weeks. The extreme temperatures limited the growth of the trees as well as their ability to sprout leaf buds after winter freezes. In fact, recent studies have found the species less cold-hardy than both red oaks and sugar maples, suffering permanent stem and bud damage at negative 18 degrees Fahrenheit. Needless to say, the drier and colder climate of the last glacial maximum, coupled with the sandy, nutrient-poor soils of the Gulf Coastal Plain, made the survival of the American chestnut tenuous at best. Where conditions were most favorable were the areas closer to the present coastline and along the submerged shelf of the Gulf and Atlantic coasts. As noted earlier, sea levels dropped considerably during the peak of the last ice age, causing the Gulf and Atlantic shorelines to extend 60 miles beyond their present location. According to University of South Florida Professor Emeritus Richard A. Davis, the sea level drop exposed more than 62,000 square miles of terrain along the Gulf of Mexico, including areas that would have been suitable to the species. While much of the southeast interior was in a deep freeze during the coldest winter months, conditions near and beyond the present shoreline were both milder and wetter. The waters of the Atlantic Ocean and Gulf of Mexico served as a buffer to the effects of the Laurentide ice sheet, as they were only 2 degrees cooler during the glacial peak. Consequently, when southerly winds swept across the warm sea surface, they created a thermal enclave that was beneficial to warm, temperate tree species occupying the coastline. Isochronic weather maps of the period reveal a narrow band extending from the Savannah, Georgia to Mobile, Alabama areas where surface temperatures and rainfall amounts fall within the range of viability for all Castanea species. In fact, the atmospheric conditions there were not unlike those found at the northern end of the tree's present range in New England, where mean January temperatures fluctuate between 18 degrees Fahrenheit and 25 degrees Fahrenheit, and rainfall amounts between 35 and 40 inches annually. If chestnuts did occupy the Gulf and Atlantic shorelines and the now submerged ocean floor at the end of the last ice age, then why is there so little pollen evidence supporting that claim? One reason is that lake bottom sediments in coastal areas are often disturbed by erosion, droughts, hurricanes, severe flooding, and the large roots of trees and woody plants. Along the coastline, pollen grains and the corresponding materials for carbon dating accumulate so sporadically that sediment layers and their contents cannot always be linked to specific periods of geologic history. Moreover, the more open woodlands of the late Pleistocene allowed for the wider dispersal and diffusion of chestnut pollen, so trees located greater distances from a palynological study area would have left little trace of their presence. Evidence amassed in recent decades, however, suggests the American chestnut did, in fact, occupy areas near and beyond the present shoreline during the peak of the last ice age. Frederick J. Rich, professor of geology at Georgia Southern University, for example, recovered chestnut pollen at several barrier islands and other offshore locations. In the St. Mary's River drainage basin, near the ancient shoreline, Castanea pollen was recorded at rates as high as 6.4%. Pollen grains dating from the glacial maximum were also removed from the ocean floor at Gray's Reef National Marine Sanctuary, with one location registering more than 2% of the total pollen sum. At St. Catherine's Island, located just offshore in the Ogeechee River Basin, chestnuts were the third most common tree species, falling behind oaks and pines in frequency. Taken together, these findings provide conclusive evidence that, at the peak of the last ice age, fluvial river systems located near and along the continental shelf were the primary refuge areas for the species. This also means that the chestnuts inhabiting the Camel Lake area 28,000 years ago migrated southward along the Chattahoochee and Apalachicola rivers before putting down roots somewhere near or beyond the present shoreline. The chestnuts at Goshen Springs also moved southward, following both the Kaneka and Chattahoochee rivers before stopping, as topography and atmospheric conditions allowed, below present-day Panama City. In fact, all of the terminal riverine floodplains of the coastal southeast, from Mobile Bay to the Savannah River, would have provided suitable habitat for the trees, as these were the only areas possessing the climate and topography required for their long-term survival. While these locations may seem like unlikely places of refuge for a species associated with the Appalachian Highlands, some of these areas remain, even today, important sanctuaries for mixed mesophytic hardwoods, including white oak, hickory, persimmon, basswood, tulip tree, ironwood, beech, ash, and holly. For 8,000 years, the American chestnut survived in the coastal forests of the southeast, expanding or shrinking its range as meteorological and soil conditions allowed. Chestnuts never reached dominance anywhere in the forest canopy, however, as competition from other species, including conifers, limited their growth and spread. The variety and number of species sharing the landscape with chestnuts is remarkable, evidence that late Pleistocene forest communities were truly unique, with no ecological parallel in present-day North America. On St. Catherine's Island, chestnuts lived alongside northern and southern conifers, ash, birch, beech, oaks, hickories, maples, sweetgum, alder, elm, and numerous other trees. Some of the castanea pollen recovered at these sites was also left by chinkapins, as pollen grains from the two species are virtually indistinguishable. However, because the pollen percentages consistently remain above 2% in the palynological record, the American chestnut is the most likely source. Allegheny chinkapins seldom produce large amounts of pollen, as the trees are smaller in size, seldom grow in large stands, and nearly always occupy the forest understory, thereby limiting pollen dispersal. In fact, in the modern era, palynological investigations of areas dominated by chinkapins seldom record pollen rates higher than 0.5% of the total sum. Around 20,000 years ago, the Laurentide ice sheet slowly began retreating, reversing direction in erratic starts and stops. As the frozen ice pack melted and moved incrementally northward, southern biomes shifted their borders, with some decreasing, some expanding, and others disappearing entirely. It is doubtful the American chestnut immediately followed the shrinking glacier northward, as the climate did not appreciably warm for several more millennia. Indeed, it would take 2,000 years of climate change to significantly alter the forest composition of the southeastern United States, although certain tree species were certainly expanding or reducing their range as early as 19,000 years BP. At that time, the total area inhabited by chestnuts was less than 50,000 square miles, which increased the likelihood that refugia populations exchanged pollen and thus hybridized with other castanea species. In fact, studies by phylogeographers, individuals who use molecular DNA to document the geographic and evolutionary histories of plants and animals, have shown that some chestnut trees do share a portion of their genome with both Allegheny and Ozark chinquapins. Such findings certainly complicate the evolutionary history of the species, as Fenny Dane, professor emeritus at Auburn University, states it, but they also say a great deal about the genetic diversity needed before the tree can be successfully reintroduced into the eastern deciduous forest. Agents of tree seed dispersal. 18,000 years ago, the American chestnut was again on the move, pushing northward as environmental conditions allowed. The tree's path away from the shrinking coastline was influenced by a number of variables, including rainfall, temperature, soil type, and summer winds, which aided pollination. Although chestnuts are monoecious, possessing both male and female flowers, pollen is needed from another tree before successful fertilization can occur. Bottomland estuaries, which had previously been safe havens for chestnuts, were less welcoming as glacial runoff and heavier rainfall amounts caused periodic flooding and the expansion of wetlands. Major river systems also served as barriers to east-west and west-east movement, providing natural corridors for the trees as they moved away from their Ice Age homelands. This also explains why phylogeographic studies of castanea species reveal a pattern in their distribution, with Ozark chinquapins dominating the western edge of the American chestnut's range and Allegheny chinquapins the eastern flank. Not surprisingly, where the American chestnut had the greatest opportunity to coexist with chinquapins is where one finds the most hybridization between the species. In areas unbroken by mountains or large watersheds, there are trees that morphologically resemble the American chestnut, but with DNA haplotypes identifying them as Allegheny or Ozark chinquapins, or American chestnut chinquapin hybrids. The advancement of trees northward also required the presence of birds and mammals, as nut-bearing trees have no other means of moving themselves across the landscape. Indeed, in order for the species to arrive at journey's end 18 millennia later, the species had to extend its range no less than 110 yards annually. While squirrels, chipmunks, and woodland mice accounted for a portion of that shift in territory, blue jays, American crows, and passenger pigeons transported the greatest number of trees. Blue jays were the most consistent movers of chestnuts, as they not only have the ability to store numerous chestnuts in their esophagus, but also cache them in the ground, thus increasing the likelihood of germination. In fact, recent studies have found that a single flock of jays scatter hoard tens of thousands of acorns or beechnuts in a single season, over distances ranging from 110 yards to 2.5 miles. More importantly, blue jays often store nuts in young, successional patches, ideal locations for chestnut regeneration. In the late 19th century, when the American naturalist John Burroughs observed jays hiding chestnuts outside his cabin window, he noted they brought them from a near tree and covered them up in the grass, putting but one in a place. When later reflecting on this behavior, Burroughs mused that the jays were really planting chestnuts instead of hoarding them. Another bird responsible for the northerly migration of trees was the American crow, which has received little attention as a mover of chestnuts, but undoubtedly transported them over considerable distances. In a study of the American chestnut in southern Maryland published in 1904, Forester Raphael Zahn noted that Chestnut seedlings are most frequently found at the tops of hills. The nuts are brought there by crows and squirrels. Crows were certainly regular consumers of chestnuts, as D.D. Stone of Oswego, New York, noted in 1911. Crows are great lovers of chestnuts and do lots of mischief in chestnut groves, stealing the nuts from the burrs that are open, wrote Stone. A few miles south of here are many chestnut groves, and in fall the crows are more numerous there than here. Crows, like their blue jay cousins, also cache nuts in the ground, and there are published studies recording how many they buried for later use. A study of the caching behavior of crows in California, for instance.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.